us to take or to bring.
Wait, so you were saying those both are dates?
Yes. Well, they have dates within that, them, yes.
You don't know where that go in, you don't know where that comes. Is that why you don't know where the
Yeah. But like, you're, where are you going?
Right. The location.
It's like, when are you coming? Okay. Okay. Definiteness. So you might be familiar with definiteness and like this and that, these and those. So this is just a little chart saying like definite this, these, and that are typically used for definite ideas. Like definite, like in your hand, this book versus that book over there. So
if it's far away, pretty much it's not definite anymore.
Yeah.
Yes. But it's like if there's only one book and I literally need that book, is it still not definite?
So like those kind of terms are a little bit confusing, just that the fact that when we say something like a definite article is the, and then an indefinite article is a.
Yeah.
So like I'm just saying like the first, as in this is like the typical grammatical meaning of this and that.
Mm-hmm.
So this is always definite, that is always indefinite. However, like I showed here, a is indefinite. And like you said, like that one over there,
mm-hmm.
it can be definite for sure. Like, don't get me wrong, but those are just terms that we use typically for grammar. Okay. For these pronouns or determiners. But like if I said I cut my finger with a knife and I was holding the knife, does a knife actually, is it still indefinite? Okay. Right. So that's
yes, no.
It is still definite,
okay.
Even though it's a knife, because it's like, oh, I just cut my finger with a knife. And the person sees the knife, I was like, oh, okay. Obviously, yes, you cut yourself. All right, prototype and stereotype. So this is going to be on the test most likely, and it's just the differentiation of what, this is what I saw most people tripped up on, is it says, what is the prototype of an apple, for example? And, or I gave this example of an evergreen tree. So the prototype is the object that is the thing, okay? Whereas the stereotype is describing that prototypical object. So the prototype is an evergreen tree. The stereotype is has leaves throughout the year, always green, da 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 da. Those are the stereotypes for an evergreen tree. Okay, so stereotypes are the describing things. Prototype is the actual object. Okay, so stereotype a nationality that is unusually kind, it says A all the time.
Canada.
A Canadian. Any of them, because they're all super nice, right?
Okay.
See, that's a synthetic sentence. Anyway. Does that make sense? So just make sure prototype is the object. So if it says, like, what is the prototype? And then it has three descriptions of a prototype. And those would be stereotypes. They're not going to be a prototype. The prototype is going to be just an example, like a Canadian or an evergreen tree. Sense. You did this with the dialects, like Southwestern American or Indian English or whatever. So you picked that prototype of a language, well, that extension, like that one, and then you made stereotypes by describing that language. Okay. Did you have a question, Garrett?
Well, I think it's just hard because in popular culture, like, stereotype means prototype, like, oh, that's stereotypical, like, no, that's actually not what I mean linguistically.
Yes.
So
that's why a lot of people probably got it wrong last semester. Just want to make sure you guys know for sure. Yes, that's right.
So back to the apple. You said green apple.
Yes. That wasn't even a question. That wasn't even an answer. I said E, green apple. I wrote it in, just for fun.
Oh.
But yes.
Prototype for an apple would be like a red apple, right?
Yeah.
Because that's give your teacher the red apple.
Yes, that would be the answer to that question. I don't know if it's going to be a red
apple. Well, I'm just saying, and then if you were stereotyping an apple, green apple, green apple is a prototype.
What is the prototype of an apple?
Right.
A red apple. Yeah, yeah. What is the stereotype of an apple? Then you would say, oh, red skin comes from a blah, blah, blah tree.
Did you say fruit?
Yeah. Any other questions?
Okay. So, the stereotype is just like the description of the thing. It's not, most of the time, then you're actually using like adjectives more than like an actual thing.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Got it.
The thing about the test, stereotype will never be one word.
Yes.
It's good, yeah, that's a good way to say it. Prototype. Yeah. I just think of prototype as in like the object. It's like, oh, like the inventor made a new prototype for the steam engine. And then it's like, here's the object. And it's like, oh, what does the steam engine do? It's like, oh, it runs on like steam. Okay. Prototypical attractive male. Okay. So what are the stereotypes? Round face means they're a little bit bigger.
This is wrong.
Moving on. Sorry, I'll jump.
That's better.
I'm sorry, I'm thick.
Okay, when I say dog, which dog is a prototype for you? Is it this one?
No.
What about like this one?
Yeah.
Or maybe this one.
No.
This is the dog I grew up with, or the type of dog I grew up with. So that would be probably the prototype for me. But for most people, it's going to be probably like that one, or maybe that one. Okay. So the extension of the prototype of all these other dogs, that's just the extension. Sorry, I just like said that kind of in circles. So it makes sense. The extension's like pretty like just you did this with the pencil and the book and the what else was it?
Flower.
Yeah. So like the prototype you said which one it is, and then the extension maybe this Pomeranian dog. Okay. So just keep that in mind. It's like maybe a question could be like what the prototype is a dog, a golden retriever. What are extensions of that? Then we'll list a few examples, and maybe we'll have something like flower as like the answer.
Got it.
Okay.
That would be wrong.
Alright. Let's see, synonymy. Important things to know. So there's a difference between synonyms and periphrasis. Who can tell me what the difference is? Yes, Lainey.
So I'm going to go out on a limb here and say synonymy is with words. It's at the level of words, and
paraphrasis.
Paraphrasis has to do with phrases.
Yes, exactly. So like, for example, raised and obliterated, like they are synonyms of each other. However, in order to convey the same idea, raise the town, or they have to also say was obliterated, or wait. So like periphrasis is like based on phrases or sentences. So like I said the same two things, but they're using completely different phrases, switching things around, but they still have the same kinds of ideas. Okay, yes.
Would you say that they have the same proposition?
Yeah. Yeah, that maybe a little bit different in proposition because the verb is different.
Yeah.
But yes, essentially they all have the same sense. What about like the midterm crushed the hopes of the students, or the students' hopes were let down by the midterm? I'm not saying this for you guys. I expect all of you to do great. Yes.
So if you were to say like the midterm crushed the hopes of the students' hopes were crushed by the midterm, it would still be periphrases, even though it's the same verb, but different like order of words?
Yeah.
Okay.
Different word order. So synonyms are just one word that's different. So if I were to say the midterm let down the hopes of the students and the midterm crushed the hopes of the students, that would be more synonym.
Okay.
And I'm saying let down is like one word as a sentence. Just like
yeah, that makes sense.
Wait,
Oh, hyponyms. I feel like you guys may are pretty good with hyponyms. Yeah, Petra.
Sorry, so the midterm crushed the hopes and the students' hopes were let down. Let down and crushed for synonyms.
So, like, there's no two, like, exact synonyms of anything, but yeah. The same sense that, like, something's going down.
But the whole sentences would be paraphrases.
Phrases of each other, yes.
Well, so whenever there's more than just like one word,
that's different.
That's a different thing. And then if it's only one word, okay.
Okay, hyponyms. I feel like you guys are pretty good with this. Does anybody have any questions with hyponyms?
I have one question. I always forget. So is like, so I know hyponymy is like where one thing is can be classified in the group of another word kind of thing. I guess you say.
Yeah.
Which one is the hyponym? The group. The word that represents the overarching group or the one that goes in?
The hypernym
is
the category. So
okay.
Like furniture is the hypernym. Hyponym is couch, table,
okay.
Bed, chair.
Say that thing
I'll
again.
The hypernym
mm-hmm.
is the category or less specific thing. The hyponyms of that hypernym are just examples.
Okay.
So like the hypernym is red. The hyponyms of red may be red, scarlet, or burgundy, or crimson.
So in a way, hyponyms are the shape of your finger. Or is that not the same
thing? An individual.
The hyponyms aren't necessarily so like it's kind of sort of.
So just with this idea, even if you're not seeing the same thing, like for example when we talk in class, like turquoise and aqua are extensions of blue.
Yes.
You could also say that they are hyponyms.
Not in everything. For the context of blue, it being a hyponym, the prototype of blue, and then an extension from blue as aqua and turquoise and teal and cyan and whatnot. I know more colors than most guys. Most guys. Okay. All right. This is also a similar test that you do when you talk about it. So you may get a sentence where you're going to have to decide. Like, if this sentence entails the other one or not. So periphrases are basically entailments of each other. So they're not entailments, they're just paraphrasing each other. Entailment means that sentence A entails sentence B, but sentence B does not entail sentence A necessarily. Okay? So, like, Jesse was eating a tulip. Mean entails that Jesse is eating a flower. But me eating a flower does not entail that I'm eating a tulip.
I'm not necessarily
eating flowers. I'm not eating. I don't like flowers. Okay. So what about these two sentences? Semantic students are studying for their semantics midterm. Does that entail semantic students are in a semantics class?
Yes.
But does being in a semantics class mean that you are always studying for a midterm?
No,
no great, because like after this, you have no midterm. She's just okay.
Hi, brother.
It's not true. Okay. I go over this again. You can tell when I like started and stopped like working on this PowerPoint. Alright, antonymy. I want to make sure you guys are like super solid on the four different types of antonymy. So like I've put these all on one slide to kind of give you the concept. And I put two like that are a little bit tricky, especially with gradable and converse, where you do have like one word like high and higher than, whereas like one is gradable and the other is converse. Okay. So let me just go over them real quick first. What is binary? What are binary? Yeah, it's one or the other, can't be either. So like a lot of different comedians, they like play off of this. Like, oh, Parks and Rec says, so how married is she? kind of inappropriate, but like that's my kind of idea. It's like, it's like people are playing off of that idea that like there's some sort of in between, but in real sense, just like normal traditional word, married or unmarried, you can't be like an in between or like gray or anything. And Princess Bride, she's only half dead, so forth. Gradable, I just do this simple test. If you can add very before it, it's a gradable. So, like, in the sense that a lot of times people say, like, oh, he's very Mormon, but is Mormon a binary adjective or converse? Gradable, sorry.
Binary.
Yes, exactly. You're either Mormon or not.
It's a converse.
But, like, they're saying in the sense is, like, they follow or they're, like, super, like, active doing everything as Mormons. Okay. So tall, very tall, short, very short. Those are all gradable kinds of things. So if you can put very in it, it's gradable. So I believe in the fact that all of us will be able to be saved through grace. So we don't need a grade, right? Like we'll all hopefully pass.
Get wrecked. So
does that mean semantics is different. Semantics is gradable. It's very semantics. So, okay. Converse. Now, what is the difference between binary and converse?
Converse entails a relationship.
Exactly. Yes, I got super excited. Yes. So that means that, like, if one thing exists, that means that the other one exists as well. So parent, child, you can't be a parent without a child. You can't be an employee without an employer. Except mine got fired, so I don't have an employer technically. Whatever, it doesn't matter. I had an employer at one point, right?
But like even if like we are all hired somewhere. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And
like the parent.
Except for the self-employed people.
Yes. I'm my own boss.
They employ themselves, so they're both employed and employed.
Who's employed?
In all of the conversation.
So then taller as an adjective, that means that you're taller than something. So that means that someone is shorter than you. So for short people, there's both. All right. Mutually compatible. I'm just gonna read this off. A group of things that are compared together commonly, but they aren't really opposites. They cannot be merged in any way. So you can't be summer and winter at the same time, except in Utah.
Yeah. Utah's got
okay. But no, really, like there are seasons and there's very clear cuts. But like spring doesn't mean it's necessarily the opposite of autumn. Yes.
So all of these mutual incompatibles, they're all hyphenins of the same thing.
Yep.
Okay. Yes.
Except cheesecake. Cheesecake
is
not a hyphen. Yeah. All right. So if I ask you,
it's what I build myself on.
So that's an idea. Give me just any antonym, any other antonym. That hasn't.
Mm.
It
hasn't.
You could do good.
Pretty.
Pretty. Is pretty what?
Gradable.
It's great. Good. Does anybody have questions on this? Cementicity. Cool. So like there's different types of semantic prosody, like size, like big and small, and there's also like the difference between abstract and concrete. We kind of did this when Dr. Davies came in, but for the most part it'll be just a question on positive and negative. So just as an example, the doctor said that I contracted A, B, C, or D.
A cheesecake.
Happiness. All right, so contracted is positive or negative?
Negative.
So, like, as much as we love to contract cheesecake or happiness or love, contracted is not the right word for it because it has negative consequences. Yes.
So, you said, like, when we're on the test, it's only being positive and negative. Like, is it going to be something like we just saw? Or
yes.
Is it
I'm just, like, making a super apparent thing.
Yeah.
Making sure it's, like,
but hers will be
an infectious disease is the only one. Yeah, so it might be asking, like, what is not softer, softer is a little hard, but something like contract would be like the clear negative context, and you'd have to decide like if it's negative or positive, and then how, like, which words associate with that. Okay.
But she'll give us words to to choose to associate it with or with not.
Ambiguity, I think this is one of the things that a lot of people missed. Not a lot, but a few people, and I want to just make sure that you all have a good understanding of the difference between lexical and structural. Who is in Dr. Oak's class, by the way? Because I've heard, like, saw a lot of examples that Dr. Oak uses in the homework. Okay, cool. Lexical ambiguity means that only one word is changing. Or that, like, one word has many different senses. So, like, when I was talking on Wednesday, yesterday, feels like forever ago, like the word orange. Orange could be the color or the fruit, and it's not really lexically ambiguous in English, but it might be, like, for a foreign speaker. However, then, like, we have the word bank.
I'm sorry. Do I have it on here?
I don't want to go to the bank. The water is cold. I don't want to go to the bank. I have no money anyway. Okay. So, and then these are a few examples of lexical ambiguity. There is nothing in the structure that makes it ambiguous. It's just that the senses of these words are different. So, buffalo, 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 buffalo means buffalo from buffalo, that other buffalo from buffalo, bully themselves, bully buffalo from buffalo.
I don't get that.
I'm kind of disappointed that no one put that on the homework. I saw that last semester and it was great.
Yeah.
This is lexical ambiguity because it's playing off of one word that has many different senses. Okay. Or can you can, like a can, a can, a can, a can. There's three different senses of the verb can. Yes.
So lexical ambiguity is only one word that's ambiguous, but structural ambiguity comes from multiple words being?
Well, kind of. If you've taken any kind of syntax, and we don't expect you to really know how to make trees or anything, syntactic trees, but if you look at these, for example, I will hit the fly with the newspaper. In this instance, with the newspaper, none of these words are ambiguous by, like, the meaning of those words, with or the or newspaper. However, with this tree, you have either the fly has the newspaper, or I'm going to hit the fly with, I will have the newspaper. Same thing with this, shot an elephant that is in my pajamas, or shot while I was in my pajamas, the elephant. Does that make sense? So none of these words, in my pajamas, is really, like, ambiguous, but just the structure of the sentence overall. Well, one example a lot of people did, like, call me a cab. So that's ambiguous because structurally ambiguous. Because one is putting the cab down lower, like, call me a cab, like, oh, call myself a cab. Or call me. Yeah.
Okay. No, I'm fine.
Okay.
I got it.
Good. Any questions about structural ambiguity?
Okay. How would this be seen on the test?
Pick a sentence that shows structural ambiguity. So it will have, like, three, for example, that are only lexical ambiguity. So if you may, I doubt it, but you may see buffalo, buffalo, buffalo. This is lexicon. Because, like, the structure is not different. There's only one way to structure this sentence.
Has different
sentences. Is there another way to interpret it, or is it just confusing?
It's just very confusing because of the location of the
question. Sorry, so two men walked into a bar. That's lexical.
With a telescope.
Oh, like, would I
make
the telescope, or was he,
because, like, you're either walking into a bar or into a bar.
Lexical. It's lexical.
It's the word.
Yeah,
even
because
if the
bar
the
is
sense
either
of into is different.
Into the bar.
It's like you go into a bar, but then you walk into the bar.
So it's still lexical.
You could argue for either way, but like this isn't a syntax class, so we're not gonna like really test.
But I'm
you
saying the are the examples we're gonna give that close or like that arguable?
No, it's gonna be something like this: the elephant in my pajamas.
Okay.
So, it's like, is the, and if you're taking Dr. Oak's class, he's super great because he teaches his grammar of English class, and the whole thing is just ambiguity.
Yeah.
So, like, you don't actually learn grammar of English,
yep.
You learn
grammar. I get a test in it.
Okay, cool. We went over proposition notation already. So, just with the referring expressions, make sure it's in lowercase. If you have a name that has like two things, like, no, Clark Kent, it's going to be CK. All right.
Okay.
If you have a phrasal verb, like to talk up or look up, then it's going to have a hyphen, but it's still all just going to be there. Okay. And then equative sentences, we've learned equals, or like Clark Kent equals Superman, CK equals S. Okay. All right, so now we're to, that's pretty much the entire class. This is the extra credit, yes.
So before we go ahead, so you said earlier that we would have to write out propositional notation.
Mm-hmm. So
is that actually like, we will write that out or will it?
Yes, so it will give instructions on how to do that exactly. But it's kind of like what we did in on the board with the word walk. So you'll just find semantic primes like locomote, space, direction, like using feet as your semantic primes. And I think that's it, I'm not entirely sure. You may need to argue what makes a semantic dictionary different than a normal dictionary. Okay, so just out of curiosity, who can give an answer to that? What makes a semantic dictionary different than a normal one?
Is that kind of like a corpus where a semantic dictionary will give you the words that are more associated with it, whereas a dictionary will just give you a description of you know, what someone says it is?
Is it kind of like, it gives like the categories of like the ideas behind it? Like it's like locomotion because it's like walking, or like time and space and like stuff like that, rather than specific like synonyms.
Yeah, exactly. It's not giving synonyms or it's not a thesaurus or anything. So don't put hyphens of this or synonyms, that's not gonna work. Hold on, did you have a question? Your hand was up first. Emily?
Is it right to say that a semantic dictionary would give more of a sense of a word than a normal dictionary would get a definition of a word?
Right.
Like, is that correct in assuming? Like, it's giving you sense with all the words that they're giving.
Yeah. In a sense, a semantic dictionary is trying to be as economical as possible by still explaining what the word means exactly, which ends up not being very easy. It's not economical at all, because me saying locomote does not tell you what walk really means in any way. Okay. If you want, as I review this slide especially, like the slides for yesterday on semantic primes, and also your reading of 16, just to kind of see like what the purpose of it is.
for the dictionary.
Of, like, why do we have dictionaries? It's like, semantic dictionaries, like, why are they important? And I kind of gave, like, a little example in section one, right? The 11 o'clock session. That essentially, in order to be able to describe a word in multiple languages, then we have to have certain context described.